Cool. Hey everyone, Gypsy Graham with the RC Groups. You're on the live RC Groups group. What? You're on the live RC Groups podcast. I want to talk faster than I can. Hey, you might have be joining us because you saw the mass email that went out to over 100,000 people. I think it's like 107,000 people that email went out to.
Oh yeah.
And we had a nice open rate. So hopefully you're new. If you are, welcome. It takes a minute for live viewing to occur because it has to send an email out. Then you have to get it. Then you have to click on the link. And I'm actually going to go check my email box right now. So the way that works is if you're subscribed to us, you get an announcement. If you're not right now and you're watching this in a future date, if you were subscribed, you get a link and it would say, hey, guess what? Let's see what it says right here. RCG Videos is live now. RC Groups live. So I'm going to click on that. And then I'm going to click on the link it gives me. And not only do you see the live broadcast, but you get a live chat feature on the right side of the window. So you can actually ask us questions, talk about Mean Joe's shirt, ask Jason Cole about his recent experiences.
With hair cutting.
Well, I didn't want to go there. It was too easy. So I was going to say doorbell. So I say to my wife, I think I'm going to get some haircut, you know? And she, you know what she said to me?
What'd she say?
She shook her head like this. She put her hand on my shoulder. She goes, you're so cute. She said, get your hair cut. I'll talk to you later. And she went up as if it just was never going to happen.
No, you're not going to cut your hair.
She won't let me cut my hair. I want to be normal. Oh, God. I want to be a normal boy.
Well, I don't know what to tell you, man. But
you should say, cutting my hair won't make me normal.
Yeah, it could. It could change a few things.
Well, yeah. I'll tell you what.
You lose all your power.
Well, that can happen too, like those Navajo warriors, right? They had Navajo
warrior.
Navajo scouts in World War II all had their long hair, and then after they made them cut it, they were like the 20% of the trackers that they were prior to having long hair. I don't know. But we're off topic. Hey, I have a topic, and I'm just going to jump right into it. Are you ready?
Yeah, we've been ready.
All right.
Lay it on me.
The focal V2s. Now, there's always some overlap I've noticed in these videos, but that's because we have these things sitting on our desk and we're working with them. We're making reviews. I haven't actually reviewed this yet. I did shoot a video yesterday and it's not my main video, but so one of the things that I was really into with these goggles is that they had wireless head tracking. So Jason, have you had wireless head tracking before?
I've never done wireless head tracking.
Matt Gunn?
Only the wired up gigantic cables going into the back of a Futaba trainer port from my Fat Shark. So the answer is no.
Rip it out with your knee or arm or something.
Oh, yeah. It's pretty archaic and analog.
Me, Joe, you ever had wireless?
I just got the head tracking module for the Dominator 3s. I've got an upcoming.
It's not wireless, though, is it?
That's going to be used for. So. Yep. So I'll be doing that soon. Haven't yet, but I will soon.
So it's the module that you received is wireless.
I don't think it still has the plug in the bottom, doesn't it? It goes to the back of the trainer port.
You know what? I thought it just plugged right into the module. I guess I didn't.
No,
know.
It does. It goes in there, and then on the bottom of the Fat Sharks is a little plug.
Yeah. And, it's got to talk to the radio, so the radio get the movement and then translate that to an RC signal.
Okay. So. Yeah. Check this out. So these are the focals. I've properly decorated them, everyone.
Yeah.
Per request.
And hey, you know what? You're not switching off of you. You're stuck completely on you in the live feed.
I know. That's how I like it.
Okay. No, just making sure.
I'll turn it off when I'm done here. So Jason and I were in the field, and we were trying to find the menu on this. There's no menu on these things. I'm new to the Fat Shark world. So one thing to be aware of to access the we're just going to make this a little mini segment on getting wireless with this thing. If you want to access the menu system for the head tracking, what you have to do is there's a switch right here and this changes your channels. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to do it because I'll mess it up, but you hold that button down. And then as you're holding it down, you plug in the barrel. And then when it beeps three times, you let go of that button. Then it starts going through, check this out, Jason, because we were like, what are these beeps? It starts going through a series of beeps. One beep, two beeps, three beeps, four beeps. And then you push in when it gets to the desired amount of beeps. And each beep means something different. So I wanted to run on channel 5 and 6. And so to do that, you let it go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 beeps, then it'll do 1 beep, and then you let go.
Holy moly.
Yeah.
There has to be an easier way.
There's not. That's I spent an hour trying to find the menu.
There's a Rubik's Cube included too, isn't it? You have to
what is it, 2010?
There's no menu in this screen, so don't do what I did. And my wife really heard a lot of cussing coming out of this office.
Yeah, we were trying to change the frequency to get on your other airplane last week. Yeah. And it was just like, there's no OSD. It was no, we couldn't figure out how to, we were changing channels, but you had no idea what channel you were on. It's frustrating.
So check this out. So this is the next part of the equation. This is actually pretty handy and it will be on YouTube. Man, we're leaving town on Monday, so I don't know if I'm going to get any of this up and out before we leave. Hopefully I will. So we're going to fire up the DX6E right here. And I'm just going to quickly show you where this lives.
Hello, Spectrum.
Welcome to DX. We had the same thought.
Would you like me to buff your corns?
Oh. So you push your scroll bar. Look how I'm just ignoring you guys. Yeah, you push your scroll bar right here. And, you know, we've all done that. Push our scroll bar, and we're going to go down to system setup. And then when we, yes, I'd like to get out of there. And then when you go into your system setup, you're going to look for trainer. So this involves your head tracking. So we're going to go to trainer, which we're at right now. You can't, There it is. So when you get there, it's going to be inhibited. Don't be inhibited. You got to go straight to the FPV right underneath the main, dagnabbit, the shadows in this room. Right underneath the main topic right there.
There's FPV.
FPV. You're going to leave everything alone in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're going to pick a switch. I picked switch H. Naturally, you want to G gear switch it, but I thought maybe I might need gear.
H for hell, Billy, yes, comma. Hell.
And then here's the trickiest part of all. I have people texting me like, what is going on? I don't know. There's two big things to be aware of. Then you're going to get the payoff, everyone. You're going to see the actual wireless head tracking occur right here on the screen. Right here in this screen, it says output channel, and I selected gear. So that's where I plugged in one servo from the pan and tilt.
Mm-hmm.
And then I made it a slave, and then here's the weirdo part. It says in the manual that this is broadcasting on channel 18 and 19. Okay, this was another hour of me figuring out what was going on. How are you? I have a 6-channel radio. This must be wrong. I set it to channel 5. I set it to channel 6. I set it to, then I start unplugging things and I plug it into the Eleron to make sure I'm getting, talking to the radio. And then I finally, and there's no video on this, by the way. And So I finally was like, all right,
there is.
Yeah, I'm going to believe what it says. And so I set gear. Let me just verify because it will be the same for you as it is for me. Oh, let me push the button here. Whoa.
Push it good.
I just knocked myself out. I've got the gear on 18, right? So if you got here and you got that right, you would be like, okay, what about the other servo? How am I going to work the other servo? This appears to only be one servo generated. Well, at the very top where it says gear, you can push in and select. And right now it says aux 1, which makes you totally feel like you just deleted the setup for the gear channel, right? That is not the case.
Dude, so, this sounds extremely difficult.
I know. I can't believe I figured it out. And I can't believe it's really this complicated. But you go to aux, and then so that's your second servo to your pan and tilt, slave again. And then I went to input channel 19. So then I thought, this can't be right. And I read in the manual, it says that any spectrum transmitter, be it your DX9 or whatever, that has the wireless trainer function in the menu, it has 20 different channels it can receive on. So even though it's a 6-channel receiver, wirelessly it can get up to 20 channels. I don't know what that means. I just know that when I did all these things, it worked.
It worked.
So one RTM, more thing.
RTM.
One more thing, and then I'll get out of this tediousness is, right up here in the corner, there's a bind option.
Okay.
And you're going to go to that. And I was thinking of the order that worked for me. But when you plug in your goggles, it will automatically start looking for something to bind to or open itself up to be bound. So I would plug the goggles in, hear it go beep, and then I would click bind on this transmitter, and then it would bind with the goggles, just like a transmitter.
Cool.
Or a receiver.
So bottom line, it's all working now. You have everything figured out. You're tracking at a third grade level. Is that correct?
Let's see.
All right.
So to do this, I gutted two airplanes.
Naturally.
I was like, hey, I've got an airplane with pan and tilt, and it's the one that had the Eagle Tree in it. And I thought, I'll just use that, and I'll hold the airplane up. It'll be great. Oh, no, that's not how that worked. I totally took everything out of that airplane to make this work. And then I took the receiver out of a different airplane. So
two planes, 25 hours working wireless head track.
Twice the plane, twice the pain.
Here's the receiver, and the two servos on the pan and tilt right here are going into the gear in the aux channel.
A little fat shark camera.
Now, I've got the prop on this motor, so I'm pretty sure that's safe. I'm going to plug
the biggest no-no ever. Not only will it just go flying all over the place, it'll chop indiscriminately.
Oh, it's perfectly safe if you put it in your lap first.
Oh, dude. All right.
I'm getting nothing out of here. So
it's going to go.
Ba-bum, ba-bum.
It's the sound of imminent failure.
Boy, I sure would hate all this to happen. Oh, I didn't plug in the goggles.
We're live.
Yeah. All right, the goggles plugged in. Let's pray something happens. Oh, I didn't hit the bind switch.
Then you son of a gun.
You want to hit your switch.
Okay.
I still got nothing. So here's what would happen.
You can do this, dude. You can do this.
I will figure this out in 1 second. But basically what happens now is you turn your head and the thing turns. And
this is the worst head tracking demo ever.
Oh, no.
You just spun the whole unit with your... It doesn't have any sort of...
Sounded like it worked awesome.
It's perfect.
Dreams are made of.
Can you see my face turning red? You can't, can you? I'm getting no juice to this receiver. Oh, man. Dang you, live. You know what? No, I can't do that either. Oh, I'm really in a pickle here.
Okay. Well.
You know, all this was working last night. I ran through the house showing my whole family.
I'm sure they were thrilled.
Yeah.
At your thrill level. That was it. They were.
You're like, okay. We need someone to talk about something. We're going to come back.
First, you got to take it off of your face. It's been 12 minutes on Jim T.
All right. We're going to put it on the best looking guy in town.
Oh, me, no.
Oh, I know what the problem is. I had the transmitter not back.
Okay. All right. You got it right.
Well, we'll find out in a second. Oh, yeah. Hold on. Oh, hell yeah. Excuse me. Back on my face. All right. So check it out, y'all.
Yeah. Joey Crane says, you got this, Jim T. I believe in you.
Oh, there it is. Nice.
Dude, isn't looking awesome? Good.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Make now it's working.
You know what?
I named this camera Freddy, and it's my new friend.
You sure Angela's not around the outside of frame controlling that with the transmitter?
See, that, she'd be pretty dang fast if she could do it.
Is Angela good looking? Yes, she's pretty.
Does Jim take 3 hours to open a cardboard box?
Yes. Does Joe Vermillion have an awesome beard? Yeah,
the guys in the comment section are wishing you good luck here, Jim.
Well, it's already it worked.
Yeah. We're glad we got it working though.
Anyway, so here's the thing. Like, this is out of a Mako, the unit in my hand. This is a Fat Shark pan and tilt. These are not expensive. Fat Shark camera. I wanted everything to be in the same family, so I didn't run into any weird compatibility issues. These goggles are Fat Shark, and I have this Cub that we talked about last week coming from Hobby King. And that has pan and tilt in the cockpit. And I was like, I've got to have that working with these goggles. And then one more thing, and then I'll stop talking.
I want you to turn 90 degrees. So I want to see how far it spins.
Well, okay. This is an issue, and it's not with the goggles. It's with the servo.
Okay. So it's only a 60 degree or.
Yeah. What do I need to do to fix
you
that?
You need a, you either have to use a gear drive one, which ready-made RC sells, that'll do about 180 degrees. Or you need a 180 degree servo or a 360 constant or a 360 no endpoint servo.
Then you need a swivel chair so you can actually do that without spinning around.
Because you don't want to break your neck. But if you use the gear drive with the ready made one, if you turn your head, let's say 30 degrees, it'll turn 60 degrees.
Yeah, so it's not one-to-one anymore.
Correct, but it's actually, it works out nicely.
Fine, yeah.
And one more thing to say, I've unplugged everything now, but if you, let's say that you're flying and you need to center your camera, you hold down on this button, this menu button.
Oh, yeah, and it'll go back. It'll go
zip. You can also manually control it. I think you can hold this down and then move your head around.
So I wonder if they fixed the drift issues, because my older ones in early 2010, 2011, when I first sort of got into the head tracking, man, the drift was so bad. If you turned it on and it was 70 degrees outside and then everything warmed up to 75 inside the goggles, then the next thing you know, the drift was so bad you'd have to press that button like every few minutes.
It was maddening. I think it was an auto set on most of these units to, after a certain amount of time, drift back to the center.
You know?
And then you'd have to push it back out.
So anyway, talk to me. So it almost sounds easier to use the wired version. So
no.
You have to go in and you have to bind it every time.
Just one time.
What's the process? Say you're going to the field to use this. What's your process?
Briefly? At this point, after I figured it out, you watch my video, you figure out the channel stuff, you get yours going. All you would have to do when you're done, you turn it off. And when you get to field, plug everything up. You could do straight ahead. If you want to do pan and tilt, turn your switch. That's it. There's nothing else to do.
Okay.
You only bind it once.
That's pretty neat then. I like it.
Well, and then it has the, I was debating, I don't know. Once again, I thought today was Wednesday, but I was going to do a video today on the wireless trainer option and how to get that going. Cause that's pretty awesome too.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently the live's now stuck on me.
Yeah, I stuck it on you.
It's been on me for a while. I tell you what, I lost my ability to switch now. I think
really? The
latest, I've lost everything. All I see nothing. So I can't switch now between people. It's all in your arena now, Jim.
On my end, it shows you muted.
Jim T's driving the bus. It's only when he doesn't talk. It's all good. It's like auto-muting when he doesn't speak.
That's nice.
Okay.
Well, Matt Gunn does have an announcement to make. Matt Gunn, why don't you tell everybody about the winner of this craziest contest we've had lately?
It is about the craziest contest I've ever been a part of.
Do a share screen. We'll talk about that. And then we have the A10 contest, which is hilarious.
All right. Hold on one sec. Let's go into flyinggiants.com.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
And here's my shirt.
Giants.com, the world's largest giant scale website.
And most active. Anyway, here we go. Winner has been announced in the, yes, you're reading correctly, or if you're just listening, the Rolling Chicken Stick Contest. In case you don't know, this is a way to start those engines without losing your digits, the chicken stick. And the Rolling Chicken Stick, the original, apparently this thing's been around for a long time, and it's been often duplicated because this one, when you start getting your product copied by other people, you have to go back and say the original, right? So here we are. We had a contest where we would you had to show us what you'd stick it to. This is a contest where you had to show the front of your airplanes, as you can see here. So I want to see, we asked everyone that entered to show the front end of your bird only. And of course, we had everybody showing the entire airplanes, because that's what people do, is they don't read the rules, right? Well, after all that, we got 5 winners. We have Cornholio, Mitsu One, Robin SP, our good buddy Ruman, and Calf 2461 here. Everybody won a Rolling Chicken Stick of their own choice with the Flying Giants logo on it. Here's the website. Here's the one and only Rolling Chicken Stick.
Look at that chicken on roller skates.
I'm telling you, man, this guy is a great, Richard is a great salesman. He's got a quality logo. I feel like I'm at some sort of skating rink with KFC in the background.
That chicken has some guns on it, man.
Dude, this guy's ripped. He's been flipping chicken sticks all day, whatever that means.
You ever watch the movie Dog Show?
I do not.
Sometimes I feel like that our podcast is that movie.
Okay, I need to watch it then. Anyway, here we go. Your chicken stick being flipped over. Oh, there's a bloody hand. Jesus, come on.
How's that in the... that's on his website.
That's on his website.
Get off of that.
I am, dude. I am. Ah!
Talk about never playing the guitar again.
Yeah. Okay, so here's all your chicken sticks that you can choose from, your different grip styles and colors. So five lucky dudes are going to get the stick of their choice. I would choose the yellow one. Hey, let me show you guys something real quick. You just watch that for just a second. Hold on.
What? Where'd he go?
I'm back. All right, I'm back. Let me show you guys. I'm screen sharing.
Move into Matt.
Are you back on me?
Yes.
All right, so I have a chicken stick. He sent me one. So let's go ahead and open it right now.
I'd carry that in my truck for personal protection.
Dude, this is like a beatdown club.
Use it as a tire checker on the semi.
Or an attitude checker. How about that? That's all right. So made in the USA. Look at that beautiful Flying Giants logo right there on the front. Okay.
So what is it? Plastic on the end?
Here it is. So this is a rubber, you know, those hoses you can see. Yeah. It's a, what kind of hose is that? This is a PVC.
Neoprene?
It's like the rubber PVC or something like that. I don't know. Someone will know. But anyway, this rolls like so. See, and it rolls very well. Look at that.
Beautiful.
So you could just brah, 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 get that baby going. You can apparently you can put this around.
Let it go. Matt, Jason, God.
I'm sitting here doing my best material, and Jason's not even breaking his face. He's like the Statue of Liberty.
He's deadpan.
Oh, he's probably replying to people. I'm over here.
Dear Ann Landers, I need a new haircut. Did I get
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, so here we go, man. Yeah, these things are pretty nice. I definitely am glad to have one. The grip feels good. It's like a motorcycle or a bicycle grip on here. I like it, man. I like it a lot. And we just gave away five of them. So I'm already getting some PMs from the winners for their addresses, and we'll send them out. This guy, Rich Math, a.k.a. Richard, he has got to be up to his armpits in orders on these things because they have just blown up. So if you hear that, buddy, we'd love to have a banner ad running for you.
That tends to happen. You know, we do a story like this, and then people are like, I believe it was Ready Made RC.
Ready Made RC.
They had to hire like three people in the shipping department for an extra 2 weeks.
It was for the cell checkers. It was for the cell checkers that beep, that you hook it up to it. And when I did the story, I was talking to Tim, and he said, hey, I think that you must have done a story on these because we had like 400 orders come in 4 hours. Like, yeah, that I was
love,
us.
I love a cell checker. I probably have 6 or 7 now.
Oh man, I have those sentries. I always love the sentry, the standard old cell checker. Where's my cell checker at?
Man,
hold on, man. I'm gonna get
look this. At this. This is like a pirate booty. This is like dig it up and be like, oh my god, what have we found? Look at all that goodness right there.
Is that all goggles? Dude, what is wrong? Man, you should have a goggle mania. So anyway, here's my little cell checker, and I've had this thing since I started the hobby. This is a Hyperion version of this little guy. But I've got about 4 or 5 of these things stashed around in various places.
Oh, and within seconds, look what I got. I'm pulling mine out right here.
Yeah, be careful.
So here's what's in my bag. Now, I've got a friend named, if you're on a Facebook friend of mine, Jimmy Daddy, and we did a thing called What's in Jimmy's Bag. So you might find a pistol or guitar picks or
a herringbone.
So in this bag right here, this is the probably the most useful thing for
8mm driver.
Yeah, works on planes and quads for me.
Yep.
All right. There's something else in here I saw. Well, my battery checker, of course. And then these are pretty universal props that work on most of my quads and airplanes at the same time.
Yeah, but those aren't butter cutters. The coolest named props I've ever seen.
And then, of course, a 4S1300. Talk about a universal battery that works on every craft I have.
Look at you just leaving 4S packs in that bag, boy.
Am I not supposed to?
Heck no. You should... You can burn your house down.
What?
No, I'm just kidding.
You better be. And then I also, check this out. This is, anyway, you can stop me whenever this is.
No, keep it going. We'll do what's in Matt's bag next. I got one right here.
All right, look in this bag.
You know what's is that your toiletries?
Patch antenna.
Oh, nice.
RC Groups logo on there.
Who makes that patch?
You know what? I can never remember the name of it because they're from a foreign country. I do have a full review on these. This is the other side of that.
Antenna. Is that the AOM way?
No. These are out of the Netherlands, I think, and they're all handmade. These are the best antennas I currently have. But this little, they also make this camera, which is awesome.
You like that bullet camera, don't you? Gets thrown 30 feet when you crash. That's good. It's like getting pinned in your tank.
I'd be crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Then we have this, thanks to Matt Gunn. The
X Square Aired, my favorite long range 5.8 patch.
So, and I'll end on this terribly pitiful antenna.
Womp, 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 womp. That's the mushroom.
Been crashed so many times, it's held together with tape. So I carry all my antennas in the bag just in case I need them.
Nice.
All right. So let's see what's in your bag, Mean Joe.
Oh, Mean Joseph. What do you got? You got a bag?
I don't have a bag here.
Come on. You got an empty bag, I'm sure.
I'm in my secondary secret location.
I got a bag. I'll go.
I'll put this in the title. What's in our RC bags?
This is my bag that I use for all of my adventures. And it is the Craftsman tool case. I got this for Christmas a few years ago from my lovely sister, love her very much. And I had no idea how I was going to implement it into my life, right? I didn't know. I was like, oh, cool. Thanks for the tool bag. Aww. And I was like, well, I have all sorts of stuff. So I have all sorts of tool bags. And then I realized this is a great sort of go container for all your stuff. I've been using it ever since, and she's happy. So right here we got all the drivers. Look at all those drivers in there. The whole lineup is right there.
Nice. And you always know where they're at.
Yep. Okay. So on the outside here, we've got some foam safe mercury adhesive CA.
It looks pretty dangerous.
Yeah. We got that there. In the second patch, we got even better item, the hand sanitizer. Tell me if we don't shake a lot of hands at a show.
Oh, Toledo.
Dude, yeah, I use hand sanitizer. I drink the stuff. Okay, here's the other one that's right here. This is a charger for the ReadyMade RC DVR 1000. Okay, so now we're getting places. Look, here you go. On this side back here, we got some thread locker. Some mercury adhesives.
Man, I use thread locker almost every day.
Me too.
John says slow news day in the chat.
Oh, yeah, man. This is how we roll.
Well, it is the tail end of winter. We're at the end of the cycle.
Yeah, it's what's in your bag. All right, so check this out. A ReadyMade RST Cricket VTX. I have no idea whose this is or where it came from. It's nice. Just in here. Let's see what else we got. Moving right along. Here we go. Oh, here it is. Here's the cell checker that sold so many in one day. This thing's got two little piezo tweeters there on it, basically.
And I'll tell you, if you have that and you're at your house and it's midnight and everyone's asleep.
And it goes off.
You can put your finger over those two outlets and no one can hear it.
Oh, really? You can shut them up? Because I thought that it was like a car alarm.
How many times have I woken up the whole house? Beep, beep.
Yeah. Here are rubber bands for an indoor flyer to hold the prop on. So it's my West Michigan Park Flyer plane. On the inside here, the best tape ever created for this hobby. This is 3M. Yeah, this is 3M 5 tape. I highly recommend picking some of this up. It's clear tape. It is virtually, you cannot pull it apart at all, and it doesn't leave any residue, and it holds together every FPV plane I've ever made. Good stuff. Very good stuff.
Matt, we were going to have your wife on the show. What's going on with that?
Yeah, she's at work. She will not come over and do this. Here's a patch. Here's a little patch. I have no idea who makes this. I think this is a True RC. A little crosshair. And then, of course, we got the Immersion RC Duo 2 with a... X Air Squared on it. So this is my go-to unit for whenever I'm flying. I've done 4 miles out with this little guy here.
I would own that. And that's a Sanders product, right?
That is, yeah.
Sanders is awesome. What a great guy. Sweet. Yeah.
I think he says the same about you.
He does. We're really good friends. We hang out together at shows a lot. What a nice guy. And yeah. He's so good looking.
I heard he was going to fly over your house and drop flowers.
He wants to fly with me. And so he said, yeah, he wanted to FPV straight to my house one day.
Nobody has any idea what we're talking about.
Oh, it's my great relationship.
Ready-made RC, DVR 1000, couple years going strong with this guy. This is my go-to recorder when I'm not using Fat Sharks.
I've got the same unit, and I'm thinking maybe I just need to Velcro that onto another set of goggles.
Well, there's your Velcro on the back. So this thing works really. The problem is that when you Velcro it, this just pops right off. This is the battery cover. So if you put it on there, if you look at it wrong, it's going to break off. I think that's about it. Oh, we got a random spinner back. I have no idea why that's in here. We've got some RCA cables for obvious reasons, you know, hooking stuff up. And I think that's it. I think that's what's in Matt Gunn's
What's in your bag?
Yeah. Broken All propellers. Right. Couple pieces of crap in here. We're done. That's it.
All right. Well, I have a special treat for everyone. Miss Ashley was supposed to be on the show today. No, actually, she wasn't. Don't get me wrong. I sprang it on her at the last minute. So, no, she was not supposed to be on the show. But
she'll be on the show in Toledo.
Yep. She'll be with us at Toledo. But I do have a Frank Knoll video to show everyone. Now, of course, you can't hear audio for some reason. But are you seeing this video?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Yeah, right. It's beautiful Frank Knoll with his side stance.
All right. Well, what you're hearing right there is Miss Ashley laughing hysterically.
No sound, by the
way. Hey, y'all. You heard that?
Did you hear that laughing?
No, we're just laughing ourselves. Okay,
watch Frank Knoll. Whoa, I'm tired.
What is he? What is he doing? Hey, easy, Frank.
He's being a witch. Oh. He's playing Pictionary or something. Woo! They got it. That's Dave Mosier.
I thought he was putting it on fire.
What's he doing? I knew this one immediately, but Mosier can't get it. What is it? Do y'all know?
Sleeping.
No, alarm clock.
Yeah. Yeah. Mosier. He's you couldn't get an alarm clock. It's an alarm clock. There's this new wife high fiving. Lovely. So Frank was over hanging out with.
I think that was Tina.
Oh, it could have been Tina. You're right.
Frank the Tank.
They were hanging out over at the Schroeder's at Clover Creek, and on their way back from
Clover Creek.
Yep. All right. Well,
hey, check this
moving
out.
Moving on. Uh oh. Look at that hot rod.
I got to fly this.
It's all green.
Where did you fly that at? Where did you go to fly that?
So. I thought about going to the field, and I was going to go to the field if you were going to go, if you had something to do so we could, you know, help each other out. But then when I found out that you weren't going to go, I was like, you know what, I'm going to go a little bit closer. So there's a park in Smyrna and called Sharp Springs Park, and it is a great place to fly. It's big open fields if you want, and then there's some nice treed-in cool places to fly quads if you want to get proximity stuff in. So I went out there with this Diatone 180. Now, this is the one John from Eagletree built and tuned and set up with the micro vector on it. And he was like, fly this thing, tell us what you think, go have fun with it. So I did just that, and it is really awesome. It flies every bit as good as any of the KISS or other flight control board quads that I've played with. I'm not a pro tuner, so I don't spend hours and hours and hours tweaking and changing the PIDs and doing all that stuff. I kind of get it to where it flies pretty good, and then I just leave it alone and don't touch it anymore after that. I didn't have to touch a single thing. John pre-tuned this, and it felt
nice.
Great for me. It's just really fast. It's running the Emax 2205s on 4S, and it's just a rocket, you know, power and speed-wise. But the handling of it is where it really shined for me is – It just was snappy. It responded exactly where and when I wanted it to. It didn't overshoot. It wasn't doing anything weird. I know that's all in the tuning. You can get anything to fly that well, but it is capable of doing like one shot and multi-shot. So it's, I mean, for me, it's every bit as good as the F4, whatever, all the other racing flight boards that are out there. This micro vector will fly a racing quad as good as those, as long as you tune it. To nice. How you like. You got to tune it and set it up. But what
It's $99, which is more than any other, racing kind of specific flight board. But the Microvector, as you guys know, and probably a lot of the viewers know, does so much more. You can slap the GPS on and you can put all the telemetry stuff. You can put it on an airplane. You can do the virtual gates. You can do autonomous flight missions, all that stuff. So for $100, you're getting just a way more capable flight controller than you've ever had on a racing quad before. But it's the same size as all the other boards now. It's just super simple, real easy. And the best part is for the guys that do like to tune, you don't have to constantly hook this thing up to a computer, take it off, fly, hook it back to the computer. You do everything in one battery in the goggles with your transmitter. You can access the full menu, change all the PIDs, do all the tuning without having to bring your laptop along. And it's just such a pleasant experience to do that. So anyway, I was real excited about it. I'm sad that I've got to ship this off to somebody else soon because it's freaking awesome.
You know what you should do, man? You should put a note in that thing somewhere where it'd be like when they have somebody finally breaks it or has to take it apart, they'll find a little note from you in there.
Be like the brotherhood of the traveling drone.
Yeah. You have taken.
So how does it do 3D?
3D? What do you mean?
I watched your video. You were just ripping it around those trees. How does it do when you want to do some freestyle with it?
Oh, freestyle. Yeah. So it rolls and flips. I did a bunch of that. I didn't put it in that video. Mm-hmm. It does all that, and you can change the rate and get it as spinning as fast or slow as you want. It's got like an air mode style setting where it'll hang. And yeah, I was doing inverted, like rotation spins and coming down, playing out in the big field. That was what I did to get used to the quad before I went into the trees, was fly freestyle out in the big field by itself.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm impressed, man. The fact that you're saying that it performs as well as some of the purpose-built controllers for racing, it says a lot about it. So it does so much more than just control the quad. That's so cool. And then now with the gates, you do have to run the GPS unit. Is there a problem with slapping a GPS that close proximity to all the other goodies on there and getting it to perform okay?
I don't know. This one's set up for pure racer, so it doesn't have the GPS module installed. I don't even think it came with it. Doesn't have that in the box. But yeah, you might want a bigger quad if you're going to do that. I don't know that it's going to be something that racers are going to want to use for practicing. It's really cool, and it's great for airplanes. I've seen a lot of airplane guys use the virtual gates. It just seems like that'd be a hard transition for somebody that's used to shooting low level gates on the ground. I don't know that it's going to help them do what they want to do, but it's just something there, and it's possible to do it. So.
Well, now that they have this competing controller, they need to pick up a pilot or two and start hitting some national races with them.
Yeah, you know? I think that's kind of similar what they're doing, John. They're sending out, especially this one, just going to travel around a few different people and test it out and play with it. And John's doing a lot of great work in the community. And he did mention about the GPS. He says it's got the GPS stock, so you can put that on there and it's going to stick up, but it's going to keep it away from interference.
Yep.
So that's cool. So good on them. The Microvector, I know, was something a lot of people were looking forward to.
Where do you get that antenna, man?
I don't know what this is. It is cool, though. But it's tough, and it's not going to break.
Oh, that came on it? Well, John's in the chat. So
yeah, John will let us know in the chat.
I think I want one of those just due to the decreased drag.
It's so small and light and durable. So, yeah.
So it's a linear, right?
Whatever it is, pretty cool. I'm assuming it is. I can see the
element,
piece of brass element at the top there, but
I think it's all shielded cable now.
And then I think it's just a normal dipole antenna that's been the outer sheathing has been removed. Yeah, he said it's linear. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Kind of like the one we did on your Tiny Whoop there in Oshkosh.
Right. Yeah, when we broke it and you fixed it, and it's so much better than it ever was before.
Yeah, it makes a difference. So pretty cool.
I'm impressed.
And the other thing we should talk about, I don't know. I mean, maybe you guys saw this, but somebody texted it to me. Guess what drone is back on the market?
Oh,
it really? Guess, man. There's like 10,000 of them. I have no idea.
Gosh. I'll just save you. The GoPro Karma is back.
It's back. Oh man, I totally forgot about that thing.
Can you do that? Will that work?
What?
bring it back.
Yeah, yeah. That, their well, whole point was to bring it back. But talk about, oh man, talk about losing some market hold.
I wonder if that guy still has a job.
I don't know if they're gonna. I think anybody would be apprehensive about buying it now, but not just because it had the recall, but because it just wasn't that good.
They didn't say if it was good karma or bad karma.
I know, that's what I'm saying. The GoPro bad karma.
Sorry, GoPro.
I want them to do a cool product, but yeah, that's, I don't know.
If, man,
you're,
oh man.
If you're that guy, you've got to be that customer that has a slew of GoPro accessories and stuff, and you're a cinematographer, and you want to use that GoPro for your adventures, and
yeah,
the handy cam thing for doing ground stuff and pop it in. It's
just not designed. I had originally pegged the GoPro Karma as great for the snowboarder guy, right? That's like wanting it to follow him or do whatever. I don't even know, but it doesn't even do that. So wait, it does follow you, doesn't it?
There's it follows the controller. It doesn't have a lot of smart features, but there's, yeah, I think it does that basic version of that.
The Mavic just ate it alive, and yeah, it did. It's, I don't know.
Yeah, John says it was the, seems like it was a bad battery clip, so the lock mechanism for the battery that holds it in place seems to have been faulty, so it would be an intermittent connection and cause those just drop out of the sky situations. Well, which next is not what you want.
No, next you'll hear about the lawsuit that GoPro is filing against whoever made that battery connector, right?
Well, they made it. Or had it engineered. I don't know.
Womp, womp, womp. Well, 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 we're kind of in this spectrum of discussion. I was on the phone the other day with a notable, an RC notable, and we were discussing a hobby in general. And my question, maybe it was his question to me, but I have the same question. How has the FAA affected the hobby in general over the last 12 months? And my statement was, I had a grandmother, a 71-year-old mother, who's a family friend, say, I want to get my husband, he wants a drone for Christmas, but will I have to register with the FAA and will they sue us if we don't?
Oh, that's wonderful. Wonderful, the people out there. I love it.
Well, I thought, okay, this lady is not in the mainstream RC world that we are. And so she's aware of the FAA, of the fines, and all the problems that they're saying you might have. And, you know, she's over 70 years old, so...
Where did she get that info from? The nightly news.
Well, so then I thought, well, maybe this has had a, this is the thing that's having a big impact on the hobby at this very moment. What do you guys think?
Well, go ahead.
It may affect new people, maybe. I think the majority, 90% of the RC community doesn't give a crap about the FAA. They may be registered, but don't put their numbers on anything. Nobody really participates. There's no enforcement arm. There's no checks. Nobody even talks about it anymore at the flying fields. It's a non-issue at this point.
Yeah, I'll agree with that, man. It sort of fell to the wayside. There was doom and gloom there for months and months. There was even an FAA misometer of how far they were, where they couldn't get their act together and how many months passed the actual date that they said they were going to do all this stuff, how many months and years it went. And then finally when it happened, the sky was falling for a few months. You saw a huge sell-a-thon on RC groups and eBay of a few people that were just scared out of their mind and were getting out of the hobby based solely on speculation about what the FAA would do. And then all of a sudden it's been business as usual. Do you guys remember the first flying season that when it started this year, earlier this year, where everyone thought there was going to be people at Joe Nall, there were going to be, and there were actually, there was apparently some guys at CEF that showed up just to take a look. Everyone was scared out of their brains and nothing happened. Now, granted, there was something out there in Sepulveda Basin or something in California where the FAA field reps were strong arming a club or something like that and trying to be jerks about it. And that got a little bit of attention, but only in the forums because it never made headlines or anything like that. I think the worst thing that's happening right now, and this is happening in my neighborhood, actually, in the neighboring towns around here, is that the county commissioners are getting a real whiff a much later after the fact of drones, and they're just now getting on the drone train and learning about it years later. And they're making these little laws. They're making laws that don't have that don't even hold any water, that say you can't fly a drone with a camera on it on public property. You can't spy on people. You can't do stuff that already is you know, there's lots of rules against flying model airplanes in public parks, but now they want to separate that with drones. So there's it's sort of coming back around a little bit, and it's frustrating sometimes.
Yeah, it's funny. The funny part about that is the local law, you know, governing agencies can't control what is in the air. They have no authority to say that you flying in that airspace is illegal. What they can do is say you can't take off and or land on that. Like we have that in Tennessee, where most state parks, you're not allowed to take off or land in,
right.
But you can be outside of that park area and fly over the park, you know, fly through that airspace over the park, and that's totally legal. So it's just a matter of being smart, doing the right things.
Well, most of these municipalities have no idea that rule even exists, Jason. So they'll make these blanket rules that go right over the top of the FAA. And then you have to sort of, if you can, you have to sort of remind them, hey, you can't step above and beyond these national FAA rules. And they do it anyway.
And then you'll get the occasional nice guy, like when we were in St. Augustine in December, I flew at the fort there. And I was really inconspicuous, had the Mavic in a backpack, just took off. I immediately went out over the water. I wanted to get pictures of the fort, and I was out over the water, over nobody. Like, I didn't want to fly over all the people walking around the fort kind of thing. And so the parker, I guess one of the rangers saw it, came over and said, I need to land it. I'm not allowed to do that there. And then as I was bringing it back, we were talking, and he was just such a great guy. And he was like, you know, if you come back at like 7:30 in the morning, there's nobody here, and you can, you know, do whatever you want.
Wow, that's what we call a unicorn, a mythical creature that doesn't actually exist as a cool park ranger.
So he was cool. We chatted for probably another 10 minutes about the technology and all that stuff. So it was fun. So just be nice to people.
Yeah, and then as far as the industry goes, what do you guys think? Downturn in the hobby? I mean, it seems like it's all hands on deck lately.
One more instance. Jason and I were flying, both of us had racing quads out and gates up, and Jason's in the goggles and I'm standing next to him, and it wasn't a park ranger, I think it was a cop, pulls right up behind us. I'm talking right here, like, reach my hand in his window,
bumped you with the bump arm.
And I'm like, Johnny Law, on your six. And Jason says, like, what? And then I lean up in that guy's window, which don't ever do that. And
I'm really.
Hey, and I said, hey, you want to get in the goggles? I've got a set. We can put them on you. And he's like, no, I don't need another hobby. And it became very obvious. He just wanted to see us fly.
No intention. Isn't that great? Well,
with all this stuff going through, what they did was they created a bunch of unenforceable laws. I mean, because they don't have the manpower. You know, I can see where they were going with it, but like Matt was saying earlier, is they didn't leave themselves any room to be able to enforce anything, really. I mean, there's what are they going to do? There's so much of us out there that how would they ever really ever enforce any of the rules that they are trying to put out there?
So, yeah, they count on fellow models tattling on one another, and then it goes to a big giant queue where there's four dudes that do the entire country. That's the way it is.
And what you don't want to be is the guy that crashes into the Space Needle in Seattle and then get like a reckless endangerment suit brought against you, you know.
Our fire went up at Oshkosh in the middle of Oshkosh, like we saw, and that I'm sure did not end well.
Go near the tower, yeah.
Matt, you were saying that you talked to an FAA, a local guy, and what did he tell you?
I did. So when I was applying for my Part 107.41 waiver and authorization to fly in Class D airspace, I spoke with this gentleman on the phone, and he is an analyst, and he's not an FAA employee, but he was hired to work for the FAA because that's what they're doing with the Part 107, is they're hiring a bunch of analysts to take all the requests, every single waiver and authorization, and they decide whether or not it fits the criteria to move forward to a person that's going to approve it or deny it. So in this case, my waiver needed to go to the tower near Burke Lakefront Airport where I live. So he called me up and he had a few questions, and I asked him, what's your job like? I said, you must have a lot of job security right now, because there's a lot of people. And he said, there's only two of us that do this in the entire country.
Wow.
And he said, I have over 400 requests in a queue, and it's me and another guy that are doing this. Yeah, two guys, and it's him and another guy. He's in Texas. The other guy was somewhere else.
It's he and Joey.
Yeah, and he had 400 plus waiver reviews in a queue to go over. Wow. So if that doesn't say a lot about the time involved in getting your 107 from when you take it to when you actually receive your license, it took me 30 days to get my paper license. It's now taken 60 plus days for the same people, because in the forum I did, or in the thread on how I took the 107 and passed it, people are commenting that it's been 60 days. They still haven't received their paper license yet. Yeah, the backlog's just getting bigger. There's only two guys doing this. This everybody.
Crazy.
And they're not even FAA employees. They're hired people from outside. So,
I don't know if you happen to see it in the background, but I just opened this box and did an unboxing without any trouble at all.
Oh, my God. That was what was going on?
I didn't see. I was listening to Matt.
Yeah.
What you got there, man?
Well, you know, we had the we said this last week, and I'll briefly say it again. We flew the awesome Theory W. I am a fan, everyone. If you're an average pilot that likes to fly, this thing's awesome. But the receiver went out on us. We knew it. We knew it was probably bad.
It's not a receiver.
I'm sorry. Video the transmitter.
Video transmitter.
Yeah, tool of diversity.
See how long it took my. Hey, these are quirks that make me interesting. Mm-hmm. But the video transmitter, we knew it was probably not working based on our research before we flew. So the concept was, if it stopped working in the flight, A, we had two spotters, and B, I said hit the launch switch and cut the throttle. And
you know what I think happened? I think you got a prototype video transmitter. It does frequency hopping now. They just didn't have send you the goggles that are supposed to match that transmitter.
Oh, it's it's like your
that's what that was.
Well, Jim, I got your other toy here whenever you're ready.
Ooh, well, before we finish, I did get my new video transmitter here, so I'm going to drop that in there. And I guess when a nice day comes out, I'm going to go without a DVR and go out and fly it some more.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it works.
Let's go tomorrow. I want to do some more FPV in with the EF extra.
I gotta tell you, I feel weird about that since we're leaving on Monday.
I know. I gotta do it though. I gotta get more DVR footage of me FPVing that.
Okay, well, Macon, show us.
Yeah, here's your Manta. So yes. Basically, I traded this for a hand tooled Billy Hell special leather belt, gun belt, which I think was a pretty damn good trade.
Internal swapping.
Internal swapping is what we do best.
The barter system.
Blade Manta. It's a little heater, man. Has the little GoPro up front. Did the review on this one. Got a little bit of bounce to it, but I don't notice it. And when I say bounce, I mean it literally, if you see it flying, it's going like this just a little bit. It's frame flex, but it's still a hot rod. And, 90 plus mile an hour, just I think pretty close to 90, wide open, 4S pack. Good little bird.
It's slightly bigger than the other wing. And I think that, I gutted my Mako. And so I think what I'll do is put the big vector unit in that thing.
No, you can't, dude. There's no room for it.
What? The thing's Look, huge.
No, it doesn't matter. It's all foam. So here's your only area.
Okay.
You can't put anything in there. There's your battery area right there.
Well, and you know better than me.
Yeah, there's no room.
Well, then I'll put my I have that pretty nice on-screen display system I'm running on the beat-up Skysurfer. I'll put that there.
You could put a micro vector on top of it.
You could put a micro vector on top.
Yeah.
You've also got these little bays, but they're angled at 45 degrees or less, so I don't think you could set the micro vector up at a between 45 degree angle and have it work. I thought it's got to be 90 degrees. I could be wrong. Well, anyway,
they are tons of fun. We fly, Jason and I fly on 30 acres out here, and that's about as far as I'll ever go.
Because, lucky.
Yeah, well, you can have a whole dang lake. You know, you can fly over any lake you want.
I like that lake, man. It's a huge lake. It's frozen right now, partially.
Well, Mean Joe, what's I know you're at work, and we appreciate you joining us, but what do you have on the boards?
I've got a lot of stuff going. Actually, I'm still waiting on weather. I'm in the same boat as Matt with a bunch of reviews I've got sitting in the queue waiting. The biggest thing I've got going right now is I'm working on that Balsa USA Smoothie XL build. Going old
makes me hungry.
Kit building on it. It's so that's fantastic kit. Everything's fitting together fine. I haven't had any issues yet.
I was about to say, what do you have on the boards? And I thought no one uses a board to build anymore. I guess you would use a board on that thing, though.
Yeah, it's actually on the board. Yep, it's the right wing panel is almost finished. I've got to do a little bit more sheeting, and then we'll move on from there.
A little more what?
I know, right?
It's all fitting together real good.
You got to watch your mouth, boy.
Matt Gunn and I are running on the same plane. A little more sheeting.
So Joe's intro article on the Smoothie XL build is in the queue. I need to finish proofing it, which doesn't require too much nowadays. Joe's a machine when it comes to writing. And we'll push that one live, and he'll get started on his 20-part build of the Smoothie XL. How many parts do you think?
I'm thinking four parts. I'm thinking the setup and the tools and all that stuff on this first one. The next one will be basically the frame up, and then mm-hmm. I'll do a separate one for covering, and then there'll be a flight video. So I'm thinking four total.
Attaboy. That's how you stretch it out.
So, yeah. And then we just had a couple days ago, the Prop Shop Hobby walkthrough. Actually, has been really popular. I've gotten a lot of comments, and people mm-hmm. are sharing it a lot. So it's getting a lot of traffic. So they seem to like the local hobby shop guys. So
awesome. Well, everybody, here's what I want you to do. If you're watching this and you're not subscribed, go ahead and subscribe so you can hang out with us live and ask questions. Also, I was going to thank one of our live viewers who gave me their support.
Was Andy Engel.
Yeah, Andy, thank you for believing in me, man.
Yeah.
And the other thing I
do
want
you
to
believe in life after
don't ever do that.
The whole RC Groups crew are the Matt, Jason, and I are about to head off to Oregon together. So Matt, I look forward to actually hanging out the whole crew together.
It's gonna be totally awesome, by the way.
I see a lot of steak in our future.
You too.
Oregon fed steak.
Oregon fed grass fed beef steak. What you talking about, country boy? No, we're gonna have a good time. I'm excited. I've never been out past Vegas, so this is gonna be all new territory for me. I thought Wisconsin was a different place.
It's all hippies and mountains, man.
I'm telling you, bro.
Hippies, mountains, no deodorant.
And patchouli.
You can't pump your own gas.
You can't, can you? What's up with that, man? It's communists.
So I had one more thing. Oh, we have a contest in RC Groups. It's for the A10 from FMS, which is awesome. $469 retail value. That's still going, right, Matt, before I promoted it? Yes.
Yeah.
All you have to do is make a cool A10 face. Just look, this was Matt. I like to have great contest ideas. This was Matt's idea, and it is very – every post is like, wow, what?
Someone was like, this is a dentist's dream.
It makes me feel better about my teeth.
Yeah, they're going to start cold calling people from that thread. Hey, we saw your mug in the thread. We'd like to invite you in for a free checkup. Check your blood sugar. Check it off.
They're going to send Danica Patrick over there to set you up with an anytime appointment.
I love Danica.
Oh, my gosh. That's good stuff.
All right, y'all. Well, you know, we were a little thin on new products, but we are definitely not in the sweet spot of things coming out right now. But what is it? February, March, April, May. March, April, May should be hot. That's when things will start coming out. And then we're going to start. We're already, for everyone listening, in case you care, we're headed to Toledo. We're headed to Joe Nall. We're headed to Seth. We're flying to Oregon for a summit meeting. I've got Miss Ashley's headed to an FPV race in North Carolina. She's headed to the shop over at Extreme Flat RC.
Jason's going down to Florida.
Yeah, I've got a DLG contest in Florida next month, or this month. A couple and weeks.
Just as long as you're not chunking pumpkins.
A very special guest star at Joe Nall this year. Everyone, if you see us, of course, stop us. We want to take your picture. We'll be giving away shirts again this year. But Mean Joe Vermillion will be with the Joe Nall.
So you'll yeah.
Hang out with Mean Joe. And if you see him, I'm going to leave it on me for here. Every year at Joe Nall, we have a call. So if somebody drives by and you know the call, like one year it was Petit Tong, and then they will Petit Tong back. One year, this is standard procedure. It's a woo. And if you hear somebody say woo, you have to woo back. And I've had the whole crowd at Joe Nall do that. I have a story that I'll tell later. But Joe, if you see Joe Vermillion at Joe Nall, you need to yell, Hot Trigger!
I was going to say boss man.
Oh, man. Let's make Hot Trigger the word for Joe Nall this year.
Yeah.
Hot Trigger.
So it's like this. You're driving a golf cart, and then you see Joe Vermillion going the other way. You go, Hot Trigger! And then you'll Hot Trigger right back at you. Then half the people think you're all crazy.
That's the truth. It's not a thought. We are.
Hey, Jim T, where's that race in North Carolina?
Oh, is that how you do me?
They really want to know on the chat, man.
Okay, first of all, I will tell you. I don't know if what I wanted to say was I don't know how big this race is. And I told Ash, I said, I don't know how big this is, but let's go see what we got. This says the Shallow Park, Brandon, Missouri.
Oh, Jim.
It's not South Carolina. Well, we were discussing South Carolina too, but it's Brandon, Missouri. It's February 4th. That's in 2 days at 8 a.m. Shallow Park.
There you go.
All right.
And I got muted. Somebody muted me. Jim, you muted me.
I was busy over here trying to find Missouri.
Maybe I muted myself.
So the point of all that is the season's about to lay down on top of us. We're about to start heading out and doing our thing and having a good time. And if you see us, we want to talk to you. We want to take your picture. And
we want to make you famous in the RC world.
We'll make you famous. Yeah. All right, everyone. You've been listening to the RC Groups podcast. Thanks to Joe. Thanks to Matt. Thanks to Jason. Thanks to this hat from 20 years ago. And we will talk to you next week on the RC Groups live hangout.
Peace out.
Hot Trigger.
Hot Trigger.
Diarrhea pocket.
Hot Trigger, you taste so good.
Hey, Jim, your eye looks great.
It's back. Look. I got the crazy eyes. All right, stop.
Seriously, stop it.
It's still going, by the way. I guess it didn't hit the button all the way. Here we go. Stop.
All right, seriously.